I'm that excited about our next speaker because she is quite simply magnificent. Her name is Dr. Margaret Byrne. She has a BA and an MA from Oxford and postgraduate qualifications in adult learning from Bristol University. She also has an Australian PhD. Her research focus over many years concerns what goes on and so often goes wrong to disadvantage women's career progression. In a unique piece of research, she took cameras into 30 organisations using fly-on-the-wall film techniques. She captured exactly how men and women communicate at work. She found that narrow and outdated definitions of both masculinity and leadership don't disadvantage just women. They also have a negative impact on many men. Margaret's work has been published widely in print, film and online formats. She's been a senior executive in several large organisations and has consulted on diversity and inclusion challenges in a dozen countries around the world. She's a past winner of the Telstra Business Women's Award in the corporate sector category and holds three innovation awards for leadership development. She has had a long passionate commitment to developing women leaders. This issue has a very personal dimension for her as she's a mother of two successful professional women. Last year, with the births of Charlie and Esther, she became a grandmother. And Margaret wants a world where our topic today has become a footnote of history, and her grandchildren are incredulous when she tells them about a past Australia where women and men used to be treated differently. Please welcome to the stage Dr. Margaret Byrne.
Thank you for the invitation, and thank you for that very warm and kind introduction. Yes, I'm determined not to be talking about this in the future, except as something that's been consigned to history. Let me just make sure we've got the slide set coming up, and which we do. So over the next 15 minutes, my objective is to share with you some of the facts and figures that give us a context for these sophisticated conversations which we're having today, both in amongst ourselves and with the presenters on the stage. I also want to talk about some of the prevailing myths and legends, because this is a field, gender, where everybody feels they're an expert. And I've always been fascinated by this. You know, if I had chosen another area of specialization as a profession, let's say I'd chosen rocket fuel, or I'd chosen the reproductive life of mollusks, when I meet people, they would defer to me appropriately as an expert. They'd say, well, Margaret, you know about the reproductive life of mollusks. I know nothing. Tell me about it. But because my topic is gender, and everybody feels that they've got a gender, and that they've got, you know, situated on that complexity of the range of gender, everybody feels that they are an expert. My own background, my academic background, perhaps does me a disservice in some ways too, because by trade, I'm a sociolinguist. So what do sociolinguists do? Well, sociolinguists go and look at what actually happens. For people in my domain, and this is relevant with what I'm about to talk about, questionnaires, surveys, interviews, focus groups, that we call secondary data, because it's the way people tell stories about themselves. They're not necessarily lying, but they're saying what they think they do and what they think happens. And of course, as I've said already, everyone's got an opinion. Everyone's got a story on this topic of gender. But for us, in my domain, and in the work that we do in the business, UGM Consulting, we look at what actually goes on. So that's why a lot of my research, almost all of it, in fact, is filmed. because that for us is primary data. What do people actually do? What really happens? What goes on if you take cameras into a workplace? And is that, by the way, any different from or the same as what people say about themselves? And I'm here to tell you, yes, it is. We've done things like follow a senior leader, someone who is a large organization's diversity champion, around for a day with cameras. But we always open with an interview with that individual who usually tells us something inspirational, like the, you know, the diversity policy of my organization. Margaret's a thing of beauty. It's an object dear to my heart. I sleep with it under my pillow. And even the camera crew with me, you know, will say to me, Margaret, that's fantastic. You'll love that. It's fantastic. He's just totally right on in that British, you hear my British accent. But then we follow him around for a day and we find that there is a discrepancy between what people actually do and say and behave and what they think they do and how they think they behave. So that's why I'm going to talk about evidence, because the thing is that if we're going to dismantle the architecture of women's disadvantage and the blockages to women's career progression, how we explain and analyze the issue affects the kind of solutions that we design and determine. Does that make sense to you? So that if our explanations are bang on the money, our solutions are much more likely to equally be effective. But if our explanations are frankly up the creek, then we've got a hit and miss approach to tackling the issue. So, let's have a look at the nub of the challenge, and this slide expresses what we all know and why we're here. More and more highly educated women in the workforce, and it just isn't translating in the equivalent numbers when it comes to leadership progression. So this is what was always called the pipeline theory. The view was that all we had to do in Australia, and indeed in other countries, was get that tipping point of educated girls, educated women coming out of universities, good solid graduates and graduate trainees, and the pipeline pressure would take care of the issue all by itself. Now, as we know, that's been proved to be a furphy. It's just not the case. So what have we got at the moment? And these three statements are not my personal opinion. These three statements are the conclusions of different large-scale research projects conducted in Australia. And they are quite dispiriting. You know, the progress is glacial. The current state of play is that a lot of effort has gone into things, but we're just not seeing the outcomes that we imagined that we would for this amount of effort. The results, in fact, in many sectors are dismal. I'm speaking here to a public sector audience, and public sectors are doing better than the corporate sector. And South Australia, no doubt about it, is leading the pack in a really exciting way. And that's why I was particularly delighted to accept this invitation to speak. But the government's own agency, WGEA, Gender Equality in the Workplace Agency, they came to the conclusion that many projects in organizations are still window dressing. And so we're going to look at some facts and figures here. And it's hard to believe, isn't it, that the issue of pay inequality is still a topic of conversation in this country, but I'm afraid it is. So we've got, if we look at the figures overall for Australia, we've got 49.7% of the workforce is female. But when we come to CEO level, and this is of listed companies, only 16.3% are women. And then when we look at managerial ranks, 37.4% are women. And the gender pay gap in Australia is a shameful and embarrassing 17.9% if we look at women overall, and we put that together to a figure that allows for part-time and full-time work. A figure that was published just last week was quite telling, because they looked at, in this particular study that came out last week, that was funded in part by Chief Executive Women of Australia, they found that if you looked at the top 10% of female graduate trainees, so these are young, highly qualified women beginning their career, entering the workforce, they could expect around $80,000 to $81,000 a year salary. But when we looked at the top 10% of the equivalent category of young graduate trainees, male, it was $88,000. So doing exactly the same work, exactly the same level, neither category had any experience to put on the table. Neither category had taken maternity leave as yet. So it's quite a good comparison. And then when we track women and men as they become more and more senior, the pay gap gets wider until at the very top, it's about 93,000 difference, with 93,000 being the figure that men earn in excess of women at those senior management roles and senior executive roles. So then that raises the question, what's the difference over a career? So if you've been paid less than men over a career, what's that impact, for example, on your superannuation when you retire? And that becomes a really big issue because, as you know, we've got a bulge of population in my age group. So this issue of women's retirement income and women's superannuation is a really big question amongst women and amongst feminists in Australia. The difference is now $1 million, by the way, so that women on retirement are $1 million less well off than men who've had similar careers in similar sectors. So this is essentially a topic that I very much thought I would not still be talking about. My daughters are now 40 and 38, and I have to share with you that when they were born, I really did not believe a slide like this could go up when they are the age they are now. I thought it would be over, but it isn't. So essentially, we've got a lot of effort has gone in, we've got a lot of goodwill, good intentions, and progress along the way. No doubt about it, there actually has been progress. But the return on investment, including in the corporate sector, we might call that the social return on investment, has been remarkably poor. And I often say to people, if this was this issue of the progression of women and the initiatives and programs associated with the topic, if that was another aspect of your business planning, you know, for example, in the corporate sector, it would be a marketing strategy or a mergers and acquisitions strategy, and many other aspects of business planning relevant that you can immediately think about when you think about your own department's business plan. If this amount of effort and this amount of money was spent on any of those other things and you did not get a very big return on investment, well, for a start, you'd stop spending the money until you'd figure out why it wasn't working. There would be questions asked, and that's really what I want to do today. I want to ask some questions, and I want to be a bit provocative. There are lots of explanations floating about, and as I've said, explanations are actually really important because explanations tell us where we're at. And here are some of them. Women are not as talented. When I was a younger woman, that was the thing that was said. Women are just not as talented and they're not as educated and qualified. Well, that one's gone. That one has been blown away. So you can leave that one, it's been discredited. Then you get this one, Julia talked about it. This one is still talked about. Women's style is not suitable. That's why I took cameras into organizations. What is women's style? What is men's style? How does this work? Are there differences? Guess what I found? I found that There are virtually no differences in the professional sector between the way men and women communicate. And if you had to put a figure on it, and just to give you a sense of these differences, I am going to. About 95% of the way that men and women communicate is identical. But 5% is a bit different. And here's the other thing I found, that 5% difference was about women's rather collaborative and affiliative style, which, as Julia said, is eminently suited to today's workplace of knowledge economy and complex adaptive systems that we're all grappling with, where essentially the more senior you become in any organization, you're being paid to solve problems and make decisions. Do you agree? You're being paid to think. So the ability to think collaboratively, I was fascinated to see that in my research, that one has come out as number one, and it was also something that Julia pushed and that she always looked at in an aspiring leader herself. Why? Because the kind of issues and problems that people are having to grapple with are so complicated that no one individual, no matter how clever or talented they are, can struggle with them alone. You actually need multiple brains on the job. So what I found, in other words, was that the small percentage of ways in which women and men seem to communicate differently are actually a business advantage. And actually, not only is women's style not unsuitable, it is highly suitable. The next things that are said, and I want to link these two, because this is really important. And in research in Australia that came out as recently as last week, a large survey came out last week of managers around the country asking them, when you don't promote a woman, why don't you? You know, what's the issue? And one of the things that came up were these old ones that you hear a lot, and that's why I want to talk about them. So, well, the women are just not as ambitious, and they need to be a bit more confident. Have you heard that one? You've all heard it. So I want to talk about this, because in a way it's true, and in a way it's not true. We need to unpick this one carefully. Essentially, what the most up-to-date research has shown is that women's confidence seems to be configured, and we're talking generalizations here, for many women, many men. We have to go along with that. You can't say all of any social category. Seems to be configured a little bit differently. And there's a study that's come out last year that was a combined one from Harvard, Stanford, and Pittsburgh that I want to tell you about, because it captures the point very, very well. And it is a study that's been replicated and refashioned and redesigned and always comes up with the same conclusion. So I'm going to walk you through the findings and then see how that sits with you as women and as men who are joining us in this conversation today. So essentially, in this study, what they did was they got a large cohort of men and women, and they made sure that they had controlled for other variables, such as age, status, level of experience, and even IQ tests. So they made sure that they were, as far as possible, they were an equally matched group of men and women. That makes sense in the first step? And then they said to this group of men and women, okay, we're going to give you a small financial reward for responding accurately to mathematical challenges. So they made sure that the challenges were outside the professional domain of all the men and all the women. So no one had a particular professional advantage. With me? And in the first round, you got a distribution. Some men did very well, some were in the middle, some were at the bottom. Some women did very well, some were in the middle, some were at the bottom. So you got a distribution curve, rather like what you might expect to find with any cross-section of the population. But then in the second round, they set up a forced tournament. So in this round, what happened was you had to compete against each other. So the people that won got more money than you'd got in round one, and the people that lost didn't get anything. So it was a competition, it was a tournament. And then this is when things got really interesting. In the third round of the experiment, they invited the women and men to choose We've now got the third round. What do you want to do? Do you want to just get a reward for each item that you get right, or do you want to compete in the tournament version? And what they found was that 73% of the men said, I want to compete, and only 35% of the women said, I want to compete. So the researchers, because of the issues that they were probing, pushed that, and they tackled some of the men and said, well, look, Jim, let's call him Jim, you've actually, in the previous rounds, not to put too fine a point on it, you've been one of the duds. So it looks like you've got a very remote chance of actually winning. But you still want to throw your hat in the ring for the tournament. And they really pushed that. Now, what they found was that 75% of all the men said that they believed that they would do exceptionally well, even though the evidence that they were going to flop was staring them in the face. And they also approached women, the women who'd done very, very well in the previous two rounds of the experiment, and said, look, you've done really well. Why won't you throw your hat in the ring? Well, you know, I did well then, but I might not do well again. I was lucky with the questions. So in other words, what they found was that women tried to have a risk assessment approach to their capabilities. And they were not unconfident, but they were grounded in their confidence in terms of what they predicted would be the likely outcome. What they found with the men was an inordinate number of the men were way, way, way overconfident, without any evidence to support that confidence. Now, this study and other studies like it shows us something incredibly important, and it's if there is a takeaway message from my comments today, it is this one, that for women, competence comes first. Confidence comes second. When women feel competent, then they feel confident. For women, confidence does not float free. Now, that point has ramifications and implications for all our executive programs, because our executive programs, leadership programs for women, must focus on the typical things that a leader does in their job. Because when those things are demystified, in my experience, women say, I can do that? I didn't realize. And if I had to name the top one, because I know you'll want some things to take away that are quite quick and fast, it would be strategic thinking, strategic planning, strategic operation. Anything with the word strategic or strategy in it. Once that is unpacked and demystified for women, and women learn two things. One, how to exercise those skills, and two, which I think is equally important, how to talk about the fact that they can exercise those skills. Then they throw their hat in the ring because they feel, you know what, I could do that. And I believe that I am not taking an undue risk in saying that. Okay, well, what sort of approaches have we been taking? In the 90s, we had that discredited approach. It was called Manage Like a Man. Obviously, it was based on a deficit model around women. Just train women to communicate, behave, operate as men, and they'll get ahead in a men's world. Obviously, problems with that. For apart from the social justice issues, I am not a man. I don't operate as a man. It's actually a really important part of my social identity that I'm a woman, as well as all the cultural factors about me too, and the generational issues. See, your identity is complicated, isn't it? Then we had confidence and assertiveness training. That one doesn't work because, as I've just said, confidence does not float free. It has to be linked to competence. The one that is very much fashion at the moment is unconscious bias training. And I want to say something considered about this. One of the things that's really problematic about unconscious bias training is that when it focuses solely on our biases, it doesn't get us anywhere. You can see why. First of all, the biases are unconscious. Do you see the problem straight away? So, you know, what can I consciously do about all the stuff that's unconscious? Not a lot. Secondly, a risk is in many programs around unconscious bias that we become more and more and more aware of the problem, and we start to get browbeaten around our awareness, and we can't get out of that circle to start to look at action. Now, one of the things that's been really exciting for me as someone who's spent an entire career looking at this stuff, to see about the South Australian public sector model, is that you've taken a risk mitigation approach to bias training, anti-bias training, which is a really terrific one. And I've seen that it's based on the work of Sydney Finkelstein, somebody that I've got a lot of time for. So you are definitely ahead of the pack, and you are not going to end up overwhelming people with too much awareness and not much action, to paraphrase a song of Elvis. You can't read this, and that's quite deliberate. The print is so small. Did you know that 188 human biases have been found by neuroscientists? 188. And here's another example of categorization of them. My point being, where would you start if you were going to dismantle bias altogether? The human brain is designed for bias. Now, as I move towards a conclusion here, I want to acknowledge, and I've put up a list of issues, that this is a very complicated problem. Most social problems at a time of historical transition are complicated. There are multiple variables. The variables are all interdependent. And the risk is that we can feel overwhelmed, don't you think? We can, as people of goodwill and good intentions, feel, my God, where do we start? But actually, there are things that we can do. So I want to end by talking about where to next. And I want to acknowledge that there are an awful lot of really exciting things that we can do. We've moved beyond managing diversity, an equal opportunity approach. We've moved beyond just looking at engagement and just awareness training around the issue. And what is definitely the game of now and tomorrow is inclusion, the work of inclusion. The reason I'm optimistic about this is because it involves men in the conversation. And it also broadens things out to include issues that are dear to people's hearts here around culture and around other aspects of identity. Because if you're going to be inclusive, even if your main purpose is to include women, you're inclusive in setting up an inclusive culture that benefits everyone, including men. Therefore, there is much more buy-in. Does that make sense to you? The whole conversation gets that strong foundation. So I want us to be much more strategic. I want us to take on board research evidence. I want us to understand that it isn't one size fits all. There is no silver bullet. It's going to be a portfolio of solutions in any context. So here are some ideas for you. What helps? Look at your systems. Look at where decisions are made and make sure that you're vigilant about excluding or at any rate really minimizing bias that might be embedded in systems. Look at your culture. Ask who participates around here. How does the work get done? Who is involved? Who is not involved? And do something about that. Look at your programs. Make sure that they're not based on outdated and discredited ideas. Make sure, above all, that as well as that portfolio approach to shifting the culture and the systems, you also help women to feel more competent to take on a senior executive position by demystifying and deconstructing what goes on in those roles. So essentially, the takeaway here is that leadership models and organizational approaches designed for the last century simply don't equip us to address the complex and adaptive challenges of this one. And if we're going to succeed in tackling the tough issues that face us in Australia as a country, then we can't afford to measure our leadership potential in ways that deprive us of half of our talent. Thank you.
Dr. Margaret Byrne, ladies and gentlemen, from UGM Consulting. Margaret, just one question. Did the words cocksure come up in any of your academic research? Just, you can think about that. You don't have to answer that one, but...
Dismissing the question, what I'm doing as a middle-aged Edinburgh Scot, thinking about which words I'd be comfortable sharing
exactly.
in a room. I think sometimes in the Australian context, using humour and then working behind the scenes to caucus and lobby can be very helpful. I'll share with you one quick thing, because this will make you all feel really good as public sector employees. Because what I'm about to recount, I feel very confident in saying, would not happen in any government department in this state. This is in a large international very blokey Australian company, very big company, engineering focused. There are many contenders for that title, so I'm not mentioning the... And I was on the senior executive team. We were having a usual executive meeting Monday morning, and the guy that was missing is relevant for what I'm about to share with you, is actually the legal counsel of the company. So we started the meeting, we heard that Jim was running late. Not his name, I hasten to say. Jim is running late, start without him. So we start the meeting. 15 minutes late, Jim comes in and says, sorry guys for being late. I'm the only woman in the room, I should say. Sorry guys for being late, but it's giving you all plenty of time to talk about just how big my dick is. So I said, and I'm proud of myself, I didn't miss a beat. I said, sorry, Jim, you were 15 minutes late and we wrapped up on that topic 14 and a half minutes ago.
Oh, yay!
Because there just wasn't enough to say. And the men all burst out laughing as she got you there. And so there was a humorous put down of him. And then I do assure you afterwards, privately, I did go and speak to Jim and say, you're the legal counsel. What you did was actually unlawful. You could be sacked for this. You need to shape up if you want to have a future. But sometimes you...
Oh, well done, lady. That's a ripper.